from 2001 to 2004 for its lecture series on the arts of South Asia and the placement with traditional practitioners. He has been a regular guest lecturer at NCA, where he now teaches part-time. Temu recently conducted workshops on Islamic architecture at NED University, Karachi in 2010 and 2011. A founding trustee of Bait ul Noor, he is also a founding member of Hastalis, Center for Traditional Art and Culture, which started functioning in Lahore in November 2010. His presentation argues that there is a drastic difference in the way of art is understood in the traditional or pre-modern cultures of the world and the current connotations of the word art traceable to post-Renaissance humanism in Europe. The presentation outlines the traditional worldview, the modern worldview, and how art is understood within it. The traditional viewpoint of art and forms and principles of traditional art. Naima Khan is a visual artist based in Karachi. She's a founding member and former coordinator of Vassal Arts Collective and Fine Art Faculty at the Indusvali School of Art and Architecture. She was here from 1991 to 2008. Her recent curatorial projects include The Rising Tide, New Directions of Art in Pakistan, 1990 to 2010, at the Mahatma Museum, Karachi in March 2011, which ended in March 2011. Naiza has been awarded the Pakistan Lecture Series by American Institute for Pakistan Studies for 2011. She has been invited as keynote speaker at the conference Joint Connections 2011, Risk and Revolution, initiated by the International Drawing Research Institute to be hosted in China this year. Living in Karachi for the past 20 years, her work has absorbed and been impacted by the state of contemporary culture as it is lived and felt around her. Traditional forms of approach in art have been transformed and previous structures have been challenged by a pollution of politics, economics, and belief. This shift critically informs her practice both conceptually and formally. Apart from being invited as a keynote speaker for the forthcoming conference, Drawing Connections, Risk and Revolution, initiated by the International Drawing Institute to be hosted in China this year, Naiza did her bachelor's in fine art at the University of Oxford. The next speaker, Sarwar Ali, she has written a weekly and on a monthly basis for newspapers and periodicals like The News, Star, Newsline, etc. since the 1990s. Currently, she contributes regularly to Dawn Gallery, art supplement of Daily Dawn. In 2005, Poma published Exploring an Inner Landscape, a monograph she wrote on the life and times of Leila Shahzada, a woman artist of the 60s, another volume documenting Pakistani art from 2000 to 2005, titled Journeys of the Spirit, Pakistan Art in the New Millennium, was published in 2008, and yet another form of publication by her, Making Waves, Centralizing on New Generation Art, is under print presently. Sarwar goes on to say that her art, or our art, is prefiguring an identity that will resolve its conundrums into a sustainable, meaningful persona that lives across all continents, an imaginative fusion that defines its own discrete modernity. This is the post-colonial context we should read. It is the text of the art of becoming. The fourth speaker we have is Sumbul Khan, and she is presently the curator at Poppy Seed, an experimental art space set up in November 2009. She earned her MA in art history from Tufts University in 2005. with an Islamic art focus, and since then has taught undergraduate art history courses at various universities in the US and Karachi. She has contributed articles at local publications and was a Pakistan respondent for the Art Asia Pacific Almanac 2010. She co-edited Between Intention and Reception, Art Criticism in Pakistan with Rashida Sheikh. This year she was the Global Art Forum Fellow from Pakistan in Art Dubai. Today, she talks about the global art market, which inspires awe and trepidation in the local art scene, by analyzing the terms on which we relate to this global market, we can begin to speculate on whether this shift can precipitate revisiting of tradition in terms of art production. We have the first different demo.
Thank you. In this talk on the traditional view of art, I will first present the worldview upon which traditional art is based. Second, then I will contrast this worldview with the dominant worldview which is current today and which underpins modern thought, art and culture. Following this background, there will be a presentation of the salient features of traditional art. First, a schematic of the traditional worldview. The word tradition in this talk is used in a particular sense, given it by what is called the traditionalist or perennialist school of thought, and not in the everyday sense of signifying something connected to the past. So, in this particular usage, tradition signifies a worldview where both nature and man are seen as having their roots in and as manifestations of an absolute, infinite and perfect divine source. Next, please. This worldview sees the physical and the psychic worlds as nothing but reflections of a spiritual world beyond time and space. And that spiritual world, in turn, as a reflection of God's qualities. Next, please. Next. Thus, for example, in the Islamic tradition, the Quran says, wheresoever you turn, there is the face of God. One can argue that this traditional worldview is the basis of practically all three modern cultures in human history. Next. Schematic diagram illustrating the traditional view of the world as being hierarchic and now the traditional view of man, which corresponds to this. Corresponding to the three broad hierarchical levels of the world or the macrocosm are levels within the human being, the microcosm. And I think most confusions result as we move on in post-Renaissance philosophy and thought, the higher the spirit and the corresponding human faculty, often called the eye of the heart, eye of the kalb, and each tradition has its own word for it. is obviously denied or not understood, and in fact the corresponding faculty, I mean the medieval West had it, the hierarchy of the modes of knowing corresponding to the levels of being, intellectus, ratio, imaginatio and sensus. And since the Renaissance, the two, reason and intellect, are confounded. We talk of being an intellectual as being somebody who is very good with his brain, whereas the object of the intellect in its true meaning, and in Islamic meaning, Islamic term, al-qalb, is the spiritual world beyond time and space. So it is not a philosophy, it's a matter of experiencing. And that's what's called the veil, therefore. After this very schematic background, which I think is essential to understand anything which takes place in these worlds, I'll jump to come to my second section, which is the modern worldview. The word modern again is used here in a particular sense and not in the everyday sense of signifying something contemporary. By modern one means the dominant worldview of the past few centuries, originating in the post-Renaissance age of Enlightenment in 18th century Europe and the accompanying scientific revolution. This worldview, as we all know, then spread to the rest of the world in the 19th century through colonization. This view was born in the Renaissance upon the residues of a dead Greco-Roman civilization, and that too in its phase of decadence. It is rooted in the philosophies of humanism, rationalism and materialism, from which emerge notions of individualism and democracy on the one hand, and materialist science on the other. So what is the modern artistic issue? So I'll end with a selection of verses from once again, times, Mia Mohammad Bakh. His long poem, A Saprolish, more popularly known as Saprol Muluk. These verses illustrate the close link between art and spirituality. They also show once again that traditional art functions at different levels simultaneously. Functional, in this case, telling a story at the functional level. Entertainment, enjoying the art of the poet and of the singer if it is being sung. And finally, symbolic, that is its hidden spiritual message. The poet tells us that he was asked by his spiritual master to versify a fairy tale as a miracle for the esoteric and transformative message of Sufism. He quotes his master thus, "Kisse andar kasar na hove, nale ramz fakar bhi, sanad veed vich thori bhoti, chalne lazzat kar bhi." And next week, pardon. As Dr. Yaz pointed out, that in the traditional vocabulary, sanat is craft, your craft is often called sanat. It obviously has a technical aspect and an aesthetic aspect. The two aspects are never separated. Isse andar kasar na hove, nale rams pakal bhi, sanat bhi vich thodi bhoti, chale nazar kar bhi. At another place, the poet expresses the same message in his own words. Next. Baat majazi, ramz hakani, ban banadi kachi, safru ish kitab banai, sad chupi vich lati. He also talks about the different levels of meaning in the poem. Next. Jina talab isse bhi hosi, sun kissa kush hosan. Jina jaag ishq di seene, jaag savere hosan. So there is an outward form and an inward reality. It can be a whole exposition of just this aspect of traditional art. The effect that, for example, certain verses from Rumi and such inspired poets have had on people who don't even understand the language. I've seen that. Or, for example, a friend was very deeply moved by Pashto. I think Kushal Khan Khattak's playing in some car outside. He was going through some particular phase in his life. And he heard his spirit heard the spiritual message of it. So he didn't understand the language. And then it had a very strong effect on him. He went down to the car and asked the people, what is this? And then they translated it for him. He already understood without even knowing the language. So there is this form and spirit of the reality of the thing, which it is trying to express in form. To end these quotations from Satyavrata, the two verses. The first verse gives the ultimate message of the poem, which is self-knowledge as a gateway to the knowledge of God. Nahnu akram aap kenda, ikdam dur na desta, osde dere andar tere, tere nurao desta. Nahnu akram uddhis of the Quran, if we are closer to them than us, then your general being and in fact he is inside you. And the second verse and the last and the second outlining the method of gaining this knowledge for realization. Galvich Bha Vamada Ghatke Zikro Chik Madani Himmat Nar Muhammad Baksha Makhan Aya Jani. गलविष्ठ भाग अमादा धर्म के जिक्रों चिक मदानी हिम्मत नार मोहम्मद बख्शा मक्खन आया जाने। थैंक यू।